Praise the Lord. Okay, so I was sharing with you about he brought only words, and we read from John 11. And what I was saying is that Jesus had been perceived in his own time in the Christian world as someone that anyone could come and touch. And everyone that came between him left with a miracle, left with something that their heart really desired. And I said that the world Jesus needed was one that people longed for his touch, or for him to be touched. The Bible said about Genesaret, how they just came, brought all the maimed and all the blind, and laid them down so that his shadow could fall or touch them. So there was something about the person or the presence of Jesus that brought the glory of God. But imagine a world that was 7 continents and different tribes and races. Imagine the revelation that Jesus is no more with us. And I shared with you about how when Jesus was about to ascend, he didn't give them candles, he didn't give them olive oil, he didn't give them handkerchiefs, he didn't give them the cross, he didn't give them a table, he didn't give them the different clothings of the pastor or the priest. He didn't do that. He gave them just one thing, and that was the word of God. Praise the Lord. Can you still hear me? Praise the Lord. Now, if you look at the centurion, the story of the centurion, of course, a lot of us know that story. You know, how he came to Jesus. And he said to Jesus that his servant was sick. And Jesus offered to go to his house, because as a miracle worker, he didn't dignify himself. He was willing to go into the homes of people. He was not just preaching. He was not just whooping. He was willing to get down to the houses of people and be a blessing to them and be personal with them. But the centurion said, no, you don't have to come to my house. He said, I'm a man under authority, and I understand what authority is. I say to this one, go, and he goes. And I say to the other one, come, and cometh. And I say, do this, and it doeth. So when Jesus heard those things, the Bible said he marveled and turned him, you know, and he turned back and he said, you know what? I have not found this great faith, not in Israel. So many times, you know, our focus on this particular passage in Luke chapter 7 is ultimately about the faith of the man. We talk less about the words of Jesus. We talk about the faith of the centurion, but we don't talk about the words of Jesus. In the same chapter, you know, in Luke chapter 7, verse 11, Bible says, and it came to pass that on that day that when he went into a city called Nain, and many of the disciples went with him, and much people, as a matter of fact, the Bible calls them. And then the Bible says that when he came nigh to the gate of the city, there was a dead man. There was a dead man carried out, and only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And the Bible says that when the Lord saw her, you know, he had compassion on her, and unto her he said, weep not. Now, if you read that story very well, later the Bible says that Jesus told the man, young man, I say to thee, arise. Now, in the same chapter, we have two different things. What do I mean by that? Two different things in the sense that you have one person who said, you know, send your word to me. You know, and I'm sent your word and my servant will be whole. And then you have another person in the same chapter, just the next city called Nain. The Bible says that he touched the man that was dead, the corpse. And when he touched that person, the Bible says that he said, young man, arise. Now, if you look at this very well, you realize that the end is the same. And what do I mean by that? You realize that the end is the same. But the difference now is that it was two different things. For the centurion servant, it was ultimately about words. And for the other woman, it was ultimately about, for the other woman, it was ultimately about touching. So God has designed the words of Jesus to take place of the touch of Jesus. Let me say that again. God has designed the words of Jesus to take place of the touch of Jesus. God has designed his words to take place of the master's touch. Today, when we're looking for the touch of Jesus, we're looking for his words. Today, when we're looking for a touch that will bring, that will deliver the glory of God in our lives, we're looking for the word of the master. The touch of the master is his word today. While Jesus, the Bible in Luke in chapter 5, from verse 12, the Bible said, while Jesus was in a town, a man came along and he was covered with leprosy. And when he saw Jesus, he fell at his face and ground and begged him, Lord, if you are willing, make me clean. Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. And he said, I am willing, he said. Be clean. And immediately the leprosy left him. Now, what you must understand is that in different places we saw Jesus being touched. And then in another place we saw Jesus just releasing a word. And that word birthed the same miracle, the same level of miracle, the same amount of miracle that was experienced when he was touched. You see, none of the Jewish religious leaders would allow a leprous man to touch them. Yes, they loved the law. Yes, they preached about healing. Yes, they believed that God can heal. But it was never an experience for them. It was just a theology embedded in their Torah. Then the Bible says that they kept away from him. According to the law, anyone that he touches is going to be defiled. And because they didn't want to be defiled, the Bible says Jesus was not afraid, hallelujah. He was not afraid of defilement. He could easily have stood afar and just cured him by a word. But sometimes he cured miles away. And sometimes he comes around to touch you. But the man needed a touch from God. And that was it. But what you must understand now is that though the touch of Jesus left no defilement in his body, but the leprous man, you know, the Bible records that his skin looked like the skin of a day-old baby. And that's awesome. But what you must understand is that today, that Jesus has ascended. Jesus has ascended. He never gave the apostles anything apart from his words. Like I said, I can imagine them come around together and say, Peter, what did Jesus give you? Like Mandela would do, like Gandhi would do, like one of those great, you know, Nostradamus. Was there a code? Did he give you a code? Did he give you the miracle code? Did he give you the walking on the water code? Come on now, talk to me. Did he give you the, turn water into wine code? Which one did you get from him? There must be something extra that he had. I mean, he's the Son of God. But we realize that all that the Father had, all that was in his touch, were his words. all that was in his touch was the power in his words. No wonder he said, my words are spirit and they are life. And that's why today, the man in chapter 5 of Luke and the woman with the dead man in chapter 7 of Luke, if they were walking around the streets of Lagos or maybe Uganda, maybe South Africa, and they were looking for someone to touch them, or they're looking for Jesus to touch them, and but because he has ascended, he's not physically here to touch, does that mean they will not get their healing? No, they will get their healing, because their healing is wrapped up in the master's touch, and the master's touch is his words today. Hallelujah. the master's touch is his words today, and that word is about saying it is nigh thee, it's in your mouth. Hallelujah, somebody. So the greatest defilement that can take over a man's life, the greatest predicament that can take place in a man's life, the greatest threat from the kingdom of darkness, which is death itself, can actually be removed just by the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Are you here, church? The word of God is very important. God spoke and the universe came into being. In Genesis chapter 1, he didn't use his hand to do anything. I know this sounds a little bit new to some of you, but the Bible says God is a spirit. And there's no way in the Bible that when the Bible said he formed man, or when the Bible said he planted a garden, he did it with his hands. No, the Bible didn't say that. The Bible just said he formed man. So you're going to have to prove to me where you saw God actually mold a man. Because we're talking about a God that can do all things. A God with whom nothing is impossible. If he could speak and the firmament were formed, if he could speak and the seas could come together, I believe he can speak and the dust will form, because he's the one doing it. Are you here, church? Are you hearing this? I want you to get set, because there's about to be a turnaround in your life. Every threat that has come, every predicament that has come, that seemingly look like, oh, how am I going to do it? And you have thought that the word that you have is not enough to bring glory. I'm here to announce to you today that the word of God in your mouth is not only as big and as powerful as God's word in your mouth, but the word of God in your mouth is the master's touch on everything that pertains to you, no matter how dead they have been. Hallelujah. The creation was in 7 days, but I tell you today, church, that it was a 7-day speech. And when the Bible said he rested, I believe the Bible said he rested speaking. Hallelujah. He rested from speaking. He has been speaking for days, glory to God. He has been proclaiming things. He has been talking to the sky. He's been telling them, you let there be season. You produce according to your seed. You let there be light. You shine in the night. And the Bible says everything was good. Hallelujah. And the Bible said he rested on the 7th day. And I tell you, if God is a spirit, and God created everything by the power of his word, the Hebrew author said he opposed all things by the power of his word. If he rested on the 7th day, it means that God is no more speaking. Come on, talk to me. He has rested. Every word, listen, church, every word that you need to turn your life around, every word that you need to bring forth glory in your life is not going to be written tomorrow. Is already written and it is at work right now. Come on, talk to me. You know what John said? John said that I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God lives in you and you have overcome the evil one. Did you see that? The word of God lives in you. Their victory over the evil one was not 7 days of fasting. Their victory over the evil one. I don't know how many young people I'm talking to today, but I'm talking to people who have come to know that everything that we could ever be, every victory that we would ever need, is already invested in the word of God. And when we speak it, as it was 2,000 years ago, when they touched him or when he touched them, they were healed. When we speak the words today, his words will heal, and that will be his touch. Come on, talk to me. So as a result, we find ourselves, a lot of people come to church and they see the time of the word. I remember when I was in Anglican church, very young age, you know, in the 80s, and we would go to church, especially in, you know, special nights, especially evening services and Sunday morning services. And, you know, we loved the praise and worship. It was a good time to, you know, watch everybody and what they were wearing and all of that. And then the moment the reverend mounts the stage to preach, and I'm not exaggerating, we all literally left the church. We all literally left the church. It got to a time that ushers were supposed to be watching out for us. Because, I'm talking about like 80% of the youths in the church. We just left and we were looking for where to buy a lollipop and talk to somebody and talk about yesterday's match. I don't know if that resonates with some of you. But you see, the devil wants us to think that the word of God is boring. But let me tell you something. The word of God preached by a boring person is as powerful as the word of God preached by the most charismatic person in the world. So at the end of the day, you know, when the Bible said God rested, he rested from speaking. He's no more speaking, hallelujah. And that's why the Bible says that, you know, he upholds all things by the power of his word, or the word of his power. He upholds all things. He's no more speaking. He's no more walking. He's no more creating with words. He has already done it. All we got to do is lay hold on that word. And that is faith. And then when we bring that faith into it on the scene of our situation, then we experience the glory of God. Hallelujah. Can you let me talk to at least one person and tell them that your word is your faith and your faith will produce glory? Hallelujah. You know, the Bible said he defeated Satan with the word of God. He didn't carry anything. He didn't carry any candle. He didn't carry any oil. He didn't put any. He never used bottles all through his ministry. Think about it. He never did. He never even offered them to use. Each time the Bible said he anointed. He was talking about the word of God. Hallelujah. You know, the Bible said he defeated Satan with the word of God. He said, "Away from me, Satan! Get out of here! Come out! Whatever you're trying to do." And he said, "It is written." Someone say, "It is written." Did you see that? I'm talking about Matthew in chapter 4, in verse 10. He said, "For it is written." He didn't say it's going to be written. Child of God, you are not going. What you need is already in the book. What you need has already been spoken. In other words, your health has already been spoken. In other words, your marriage has been spoken. In other words, that thing you're believing God for has been spoken by the Lord, and he has rested. Hallelujah. He has rested from speaking. He is no more speaking. He's already written. Hallelujah. And so what we need to do, like Jesus, is say it in front of that thing that is challenging us, that health problem, that issue of life, that thing that is weighing you down. When you go back and you search the word of God, you realize that the word of God is the glory of God. Hallelujah. Are you here? God, he stands behind every believer that uses his word to bring it to pass. I'm going to say that again. God stands behind every believer who uses his word to bring it to pass in the same standard, on the same level that it walked in Jesus. Hallelujah. This is the promise of God. And that's why we need to understand this truth. In our text, because I got a rush now, in our text, in the story of Lazarus, the Bible says, of course, we know the story. And I think pastors, you know, that came up today, you know, talked about it a little as well. But let's look at it very well. We're talking about the power of words. We're talking about the power of words because they carry the glory of God. Because a lot of us, oh, the glory of God. Well, I want to show you today that the glory of God is wrapped up in his words. About the word of God is the glory of God to you. When the word of God comes to you, the glory of God has come to you. When the word of God comes to you, the glory of God has come to you. Hallelujah. The Bible says that concerning Lazarus, that he had died for 4 days now. But you see, they didn't call Jesus on the fourth day. They called Jesus the moment he died. And imagine, Jesus, the one that was willing to follow the centurion to another city to go and heal his servant that was alive but was about to die. Now, hears about his best friend Lazarus. Hears about his body, and then he decides not to go. And you have to understand that sometimes God is using some stories to tell us something bigger than the story itself. But I can tell you today that Jesus was using Lazarus to depict the post-ascension era of the church. He depicted the post-resurrection era of the church. He's trying to teach us something here. I love him. I could go there and heal him. You know, Jesus healed and had power to heal such to the extent that he would use it to experiment and teach the apostles that this is how you do it. So that we can get to that point as a church when we are not scared to cast out demons, but we call one of our errands and one of our hearts and we say, you gotta follow me. I need to teach you what this is about. And as we lay hands on the sick, we tell him, you see, this is what's going on. Are you here, church? We need to come to that level. That is the faith. That is the faith and the glory experience. And because that era will go back home understanding that it is possible for me to do the same. Glory to God. Now, they went, and as they went, you see, they called Jesus and they didn't come. And I can imagine that Mary and Martha were already, you know, silently mad. I don't know, but I feel like I would have been mad at someone that called. He calls himself a pastor. And I called him 4 days ago. Even if he's not going to come, let him call. Let him just send somebody to me. I know he gets busy sometimes. But Jesus never talked to them. And then, but on the other side, watch what was happening. He was dealing with the apostles. And he said, we got to go. Read your Bible. There has never been a time that Jesus announced to the disciples what they had to do. The Bible just tells us that how they got there and this happened, and how they got there and this happened. And when they got to the mountain, he opened his mouth and then he said to them, and he taught them this, and he taught them that. And somebody came and said, that's how the Bible is written. But this is very critical, because now Jesus was announcing to them, guys, Lazarus is sleeping. This was the first time he will announce about someone that needed him to the disciples. And notice that he wasn't telling them because he wanted to get their permission. He wasn't telling them about it at all. In fact, you know, one of them thought he was telling them because of what had happened in Bethany earlier. That, oh, you want to go back to that place that, you know, they try to stone you? You want to go back to that place that, you know, they are going to lynch us if we move into that place. And that wasn't what Jesus was trying to say. So you see, Jesus was trying to teach them something. The death of Lazarus was just a word away. Or rather, the resurrection of Lazarus was just a word away. But it needed the church, the apostle, to understand the power of words. When he was not, he wouldn't be around for anybody to reach out and touch the hem of his garment. He wanted to teach the church about how powerful his word is. And as they went, as he began to talk to them, he said, he sleepeth. And one of them said, he sleeps. Then why do we gotta go and disturb him? Let the old man sleep. And then he tried to convince them, thinking that they would understand. You know, in John in 4, John chapter 3, he had said, I tell you the things that are earthly, you don't understand. If I tell you the things of the heavenly things, how can you understand? But you see, these are guys that just followed Jesus. They never understood the word. They never understood him. They never read him. And a lot of us like that. We don't read, we don't discern the move of God in our leaders or our pastors or maybe someone God is sending to us. Paul said, some of you have entertained the angels. But you see, it's good that you know who you are entertaining. Are you here? Abraham knew the three angels. He knew that he was entertaining them. What a glorious moment it must have been for him. But look at this. The Bible says that, you know, when they began to argue with him, I said, no, since he's sleeping, there's no point, go. I mean, let him sleep, let him wake up. And Jesus looked at him and said, he's sleeping. He said, no, if he's sleeping, then why do we gotta go? And then he said, okay, he needed to come down to their level. And he said, you know what, he died. And then you know what they said? They said, so why do we gotta go there now? Are we going to die with him? Think about it for a moment. Because this just tells you a lot about the church today. And what why did I say that? We are in a church that is very insensitive to the move of God and the word of God. We're a church that have not sat down to use the power of what is written concerning us. Today there are churches that they do every other thing apart from the word of God, apart from reading it, teaching it, or admonishing themselves with it. There are a lot of things, there are a lot of other things that they are busy doing apart from the word of God. And this was the case of the disciples. They said, let's go and die with them. This was a man that had healed people. This was a man that just raised the dead. This was a man that walked on water. This was a man that turned water into wine. And then you have been with him this long, and you have the audacity to look him in the eye and tell him, maybe we should go and die with him. In other words, they were suggesting that he's been dead, and we know you can raise the dead. But he's been dead for 4 days. According to the Hebrew culture, when a man dies, they watch him for 3 days. And the reason for that is they believe that it is possible for him to still come back alive. So they watch him for 3 days. And on the fourth day, they take him into the tomb. And that was the case of Lazarus. So Jesus waited until the fourth day so that every tradition would be questioned. Come on, talk to me. So that nothing would go unquestioned. So that the word of God will stand in its own class. Glory to God. And the Bible, as they went, Jesus said, you see, Jesus would not even call him dead. Hallelujah. Jesus would not even call him dead. Jesus could not call him dead. He could not say, you know what? He is dead. He struggled to tell them because he knew the power of his word. That the moment he said Lazarus was dead, then Lazarus was really, really dead. Hallelujah. So Lazarus, the story of Lazarus mirrors the post-ascension reality of the church. That we must get to a point where we understand that Jesus is absent in the body is actually an addition or an advantage. We never missed him. We have never missed him. We don't think, oh, maybe when he comes, this is going to happen. That's why I believe he hasn't come. Because his church have not discovered some things and the glory that they are supposed to walk in. Hallelujah. And so when they began to go, now remember that they were just following him to go and die. And so you can imagine him walking in the midst of people who had no faith. And now Martha came to meet him at the gate of the city and said to him, and he said, if you had come earlier, so I'll say earlier. He said, if you had come earlier, then my brother would not have died. In other words, I believed until it was late. I believed until it was the fourth day. I know healing the sick and raising the dead is not a big deal. But right now, we're just about 45 days to the end of the year. I don't really think there's much you can do right now. Am I talking to somebody? You know, not much we can do now. I mean, the day of the great rising and shining has just ended as far as I'm concerned. Normally, we used to announce the word for the month, for the year, the coming year, doing sovereign, usually tonight. Hallelujah. But you see, Jesus was not late. Hallelujah. I said Jesus was not late. You know, so Jesus was not physically around for 4 days. But now he was coming at the end of the fourth day. And I would have thought that Jesus would carry with him maybe a big Bible. I mean, I can imagine the religious church today who wants to operate in the supernatural. I can imagine where they are. I can imagine having the burden to go and minister life to people somewhere. I mean, I've seen people who have exaggerated the outer court things more than the real things in ministry. I have seen people who have celebrated emptiness. I've seen people who are excited about nothing, but they still call it a church. Jesus was going with an entourage, and I would say faithless entourage, but he won't stop there. That won't change his mind. Remember, he would not even call him dead. He said, no, he's sleeping. No, he's sleeping. And let me tell you, church, as long as Jesus said he was sleeping, Lazarus was sleeping. He looked dead to everybody around, but Lazarus was sleeping. Hallelujah. I don't know what's sleeping dead right now in your life, and I don't know where you are. But there's someone right now, you can hear me, you have this growth, you know, around your loins. You have this growth around your loins. And I see God not only saying that he's going to heal you, God is telling me that he's melting that thing right now, so that before you leave this meeting right now, God is melting. He's melting that growth. I command every growth. You don't have to be ashamed. If you are the one, you can start up. If you're the one I'm talking to, you can start up. This is not a time for shame. Come on. If you're the one, stand up. You have a growth, you know, somewhere in your scrotum or wherever, there's growth somewhere. And you are afraid about whatever it has, is whatever it is, but I see it melting right now. Raise your hand if you're the one or whoever it is, because God is about to heal you right now. Thank you for that hand, because I know God is healing you right now. He's healing you because it looks like it's been there for a while. It looked like it's been long. It looked like, oh, this is the fourth day. But I tell you, on the fourth day, he's coming with words. Hallelujah. I said, on the fourth day, he's coming with words. And I pray for you that today shall be the beginning of not just the miracle in this area of your life, but in every part of your life in the name of Jesus. Let a miracle in your loins right now. Let there be a miracle. I declare a melting to take place right now. I reduce that growth. That growth, I reduce it right now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Look at this. As they went, the Bible says that they were going, and then Martha came to meet Jesus, and he said, If you had come earlier, the things that looked like they should have happened earlier, that never happened, because of the faith and glory experience, today as a man of God, I speak into your life, and I declare in the name of Jesus, those things that you have thought about, and those things that you have said, and said, I wish you had done it earlier, I wish that happened earlier, I command them into manifestation right now in the name of Jesus. I command your morning, your afternoon, your night to respond to the words of this man of God. And I declare right now that you are going to celebrate and you're going to testify in the name of Jesus. So he came and said, if you had come earlier, see, be careful what you give up on. Be careful what you give up on. Listen, you can give up on falsehood. You can give up on sound bites. You can give up on a gossip. You can give up on a false news. But don't give up on the truth. I'm going to say that again. You can give up on a friend that is unreliable. You can give up on somebody that has lied to you before. You can give up on things that look so unreal. You can give up on the lies that somebody told you. You can give up on what looks good to be true, but don't ever give up on the truth. Don't give up on what is true. Don't give up on what is truth, because the truth will deliver glory. Hallelujah. Oh, it's funny how people treat the word of God today. It's nothing serious anymore. We're just a bunch of churchgoers who just loves to come and sing in church. And we just love to act and dramatize and dance and do all the stunts and play and do all those things. Church has become that. When you meet a Christian today, you don't talk about word anymore. You talk about who's your pastor. You talk about where are you guys located. You talk about how many people are in your choir. You talk about every other thing. Are you on Periscope? Are you on Facebook? What's your website? We don't. The word is no more the central, the pivot of everything we do as a church anymore. You know, Martha reminded them again, guys, it's been 4 days. And I can imagine the entourage, the faithless entourage that came with Jesus. I can imagine them saying, all right, I said it. I knew it, because this had never happened before. Remember, just like you and I, it's not like they didn't believe that Jesus could raise a dead man. That would be foolish, because they've seen him do stuff before. But what they've never seen before is a fourth day glory, the fourth day miracle, the fourth day dead person. And that's why I know 4 weeks' time, somebody here, 4 days' time, somebody in this room, you will not only testify of a risen Lazarus, you will testify of a Lazarus that went about doing good and touching lives and healing the sick. Hallelujah. So Martha reminds them and reminds Jesus, I know you can do all things. I know you can raise the dead, but I don't think you can raise a 4 day dead man, because by now mucus is coming out of his nostrils. By now it's already done. There's nothing going to happen. But let me tell you something, church. This is one of the things that the Word of God does. It does a sudden manifestation. It delivers a manifestation. And today, by the grace of God and the power of God and in faith, we declare sudden possibilities, even in your, in this season, sudden possibility in this year of great light, great shining, in the name of Jesus. The Bible says, as I said, it's late. I don't know how many Marthas we have right now. More activities in church. Marthas who have not discovered the word of God. Marthas who are busy around Jesus but don't know his word. Marthas who would rather him do it the way they understand it. Marthas who believe that the Jewish tradition about death stands all the time. Martha, the ones who will just manage and tolerate evil. Martha, the ones who will have given up on their Lazarus because they don't think it is possible anymore. Martha's who are counting days and numbers and minutes and hours of what they have lost. How many blood, much blood they have lost, much money that they have lost. How many times people have spoken to them in a way, how many times, you know, they thought about it and they don't think it's possible. But today, I see a turnaround in the life of Martha, glory to God. Because what some of you understand is that although she went to the grave, the faith that was weak, but she came back with a testimony. I wish that there were Martha's in this room who I know you were struggling just before this meeting, that it might not be possible. But just like Martha, I wish that you could just believe in the word of the master. I heard when Jesus said, you know, where did you lay him? Hallelujah. Where did you lay him? In other words, he knew that he was no more in the house. Are you hearing this? He knew Lazarus had left the house. He had left the place of possibility of resurrection. I'm addressing things that look like they are not possible. I know we talk and sang about a God that can do the impossible, but I'm addressing issues that are impossible. They said it's not possible, or it says it is not possible. We address it today and we declare that you will testify about those things that are past the possibility level, because the word of God is coming. Hallelujah. And Jesus said to her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe. Could you have me slap somebody and say, believe, brother? If thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God. Let's speak English. If you will believe, you will see the glory of God. If you will believe, you will see the glory of God. But watch what's going on here. Because when we talk about the glory of God, tomorrow I'm going to deal with the glory of God and all of that. But you see, when we talk about the glory of God, most of us, well, if I will ask one of you to mention one or two things, we'll talk about the Shekinah glory and the smoke, the brilliance and the power of God, the weight and the excellence of God, and all those good words and all of that. But for people, the glory of God has to be a praise and worship session, that somebody is falling under the power, and you know, somebody is, you know what? Let's look at what Jesus said they will see. He said, you will see the glory of God. Now, no one saw a smoke come out of that place. No one saw any praise and worship. No one fell under the power. In fact, the only people you could hear at the cave were mourners, professional mourners, who were crying. They were crying professionally. They were paid to actually mourn. And so they went everywhere in the place crying and wearing black. And everybody, you know, it was a sorrowful time. But the Bible says that as Jesus went in verse 38, the Bible says that he was groaning within himself. He was groaning within himself. He was groaning within himself. Watch this, child of God. When you are approaching the impossible things of your life, are you here, church? When you're approaching what you thought could have happened but never happened, when you're approaching a deadness, when you're approaching something that is already out of the realm of possibility, I challenge you to begin to groan in your spirit. Oh, I'm talking about you murmuring in your spirit. You taking charge. Something is about to come out of you. Oh my God. Paul said, you know, we are in a house that cannot contain us. He was referring to the body. And he said, sometimes we are beside ourselves. He's talking about the ecstatic state of the anointing and its feeling on the body. In other words, it gets to a point that even our body cannot handle the glory that is coming and stemming out of our spirit. And when you are thinking the impossible things of your life, when your groaning starts in the spirit, the Bible says he makes groanings that cannot be uttered. He was not saying a language. He was just moving. And there was something brooding in his spirit. And I feel a brooding in my spirit. I feel like as we approach the end of this year, we approach the year with groaning. I wish that everybody will approach to the end of this year with groaning. I wish you would approach that failure, that barrenness, that joblessness. I wish you would approach it with groanings in your spirit. And the Bible says that as they went, you know, the mourners were crying and the disciples were faithless and all of it looks like God didn't know what he was doing. But the Bible says, the God that said, thou shalt not kill, has come to the tomb, and one of his children had been killed by whatever disease. And now he stood in front of that place and he said, you know, is this where you laid him? And the Bible said he lifted his hands and prayed and said, Lord, I don't need to do this, but because of the people here, you know, because I want them to grow in faith, I gotta just say one or two things. But importantly, he shouted and he said, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, come forth. So it was a resurrection. Listen, when Jesus came to that place and he was in front of that tomb, it was a matter of resurrection against death. And it was a matter of power against defeat. It was not a probability whether Lazarus was going to come out. It was not a probability. It was what God said and what God was going to do. He was definitely coming out of that place. Come on, talk to me. Now, what you must understand, did I say Jesus cried out and said, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, come forth. He shouted loud because the man is in the cage. Listen, I don't know how many of you have shouted like this before, but this was not a shout to wake up a dead man. This was a shout to wake up someone that's sleeping. And I'm going to prove that to you. There are times that you try to call somebody, but because of the noise around them, they can't hear you, and you just have to raise your voice a little bit and just shout their name and say, hey, hey, you know. And that was what was going on. He was in the cave, in the tombs, and, you know, he had to hear the voice for him to respond. He was calling someone by his name. It's time to call the dead things by their name. Listen. When someone dies, there's a change of status. For instance, they used to call him Lazarus, but now he was a bear or a corpse. Your status changes. You know, when a man used to be rich and is no more rich, there's something they call him. When a man used to maybe operate in such an anointing and he doesn't operate in such an anointing anymore, there's something they call him. But you see what's going on here? Jesus was coming to override that. And he said, I'm calling you the name Labohoso. I'm calling you the name that God called you before the foundation of the world. I'm calling you what is written concerning you. I'm not going to call you what happened to you. I'm going to call you what is written concerning you. I'm not going to call you what you went through. I'm going to call you what you are bound to experience by the word of God. I'm not going to call you what, you know, your family has gone through. I'm going to call you what Jesus went through for you. Hallelujah. And so he called him by his name. He didn't call him a corpse. He didn't say, dead man, come forth. No, he was not. If he said, dead man, come forth, that means he actually died and then he rose. No, but according to Jesus, he never died in the first place. Hallelujah. And this was a man that he loved. And he stood in front of that tomb and he was talking to him. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. I should call you a corpse by now. I should call you the dead man by now. But I'm still going to call you what is written concerning you. I'm not going to call you what was not written concerning you. You shall not die, but live to proclaim the glory of God. At this point of the year, there are lots of nonsensical things that demons try to scare people with, and that is death. And people go around talking about, oh, it's December, and anytime in December, this is going to happen. I tell you the truth, I lie not. As long as you are here, as long as the word of God is your guide, I tell you, you are surrounded. You are surrounded. You are surrounded. No plague will come by you. You will gallivant from year to year, from victory to victory, from faith to faith, because it is written concerning you, and nothing can change the word of God. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. He had always been looking for a dead case. I know what he told me, he said, I've always looked for dead cases, dead case. That's why I won't go the first time. That's why I won't go the second time or the second day. That's why the third day will pass. That's why everything will look like it's going to happen. I'm looking for the dead cases. What are those dead cases around you right now? The word of God and the spirit of God. The Bible said his words are spirit and they are life. Hallelujah. And Jesus stood in that place confronting death. And the spirit of death is about to be defeated by words. Hallelujah. I thought he would carry some olive oil with him. I thought he would carry what do they call those things that they wear? You know, all those regalia and the collars and the handkerchiefs and then maybe a big bottle of olive oil, the one from Israel. You know, one of our friends here at Staten Island just, you know, posted something on Facebook. He went to Israel and he's presently at Carapace's house, you know, and all of that, you know, and I can imagine the feeling of in leaving or walking around Caiaphas's house and wherever other places they have to go to in Israel. But I tell you the truth, child of God, it's a long journey from Nigeria to Israel. It's a long journey from Uganda to Israel. It's a long journey from South Africa to Israel. It's a long journey from the U.S. to Israel. But let me tell you something. There's no journey when you use the word of God where heaven is concerned. When the word of God is in your mouth, you can control anything and you can declare heaven. Hallelujah. Whatever killed Lazarus can't survive the word of God in the mouth of Jesus. I know it's a fourth day and I know it looks like it's not possible, but the word of God in the mouth of Lazarus was going to turn things around. In the mouth of Jesus was going to turn things around. They call it names, and they have all the names for the cancer. They have all the names for the HIV. They have all the names for those things. You pass that with a third class. You're not worthy of that. You can't qualify for certain things. I dare you to put the word of God in your mouth. I dare you to speak the word of God in faith. No wonder he couldn't tell them that he was dead, because that's when he would be dead. Even because in his absence, he wouldn't call Lazarus a dead man. So when he got there, he just only needed to call his name. And that's why I say to you today, go and call it the name that it ought to be. Hallelujah. If you don't have anything, call yourself a rich man. If you don't have a job, say, I have a job. If you don't have, you're sick of the body, say, I am whole and healthy. Come and talk to me, church. Whatever you're looking for, call yourself what that thing is, because that's the status that is written concerning you. I said that is the status that is written concerning you. Hallelujah. And because he knew the power that was in his word, he opened his mouth and shouted the way you call somebody that is afar off, not somebody that is dead. And he said, come forth. The Greek word is exo. And it's actually from the root word exits. He's saying you got to come out of that tomb. You got to come out of the power of death. You got to come out of what made you sleep for 3 days. And that's why today we declare exo upon everything that seemed dead. We call it out right now in the name of Jesus. We say exo concerning your health, and we call your healing right now. We say exo concerning your marriage, and we declare peace and joy in the Holy Ghost right now. We declare exo concerning every plan that you have concerning your life. And we declare today is the day the Lord has made, and you are coming out, and you are coming out as a blessing in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, come on. There is a word that has death that can threaten death, and that's the word of God. There's a word that can control the grave, and that's the word of God. There's a word that can control the demons, the infirmities that made him die. What come out of that grave, because it was all about the word. It was not about olive oil or candles. Get rid of those jargons. You don't need salt to do this. You don't need any Torah in your hand to do this. You don't need to do all of those things, because God is about to change something in your life, and he's doing it through his word. And that's why he brought the word to the tomb. I wish somebody would take words to their tomb right now. I wish they would take it to the tomb of their joblessness and the tomb of their feebleness and weaknesses. I wish they would take it to the tomb of weakness in ministry, weakness in marriage, weakness in prayer, and have your own strength back and call forth things that be not as though they were. We are moving, church. We are moving toward an age in the spirit. We are moving it towards a new age in the spirit, where the humanly possible becomes a taboo in the church. I'm not talking about something that is humanly possible. I'm talking about things that brings us out of our comfort zone a little bit, because the Comforter is bringing the church of Jesus to an uncomfortable zone so that she can do the unexpected, the unsearchable, what eyes have not seen and what ears have not heard before. The glory, however, must spring from the surrender of the church. This glory, when Jesus said, I said I not unto thee that if you believe, you'll see the glory of God. And when he got to the place, he only used words. So the Word of God was the glory that Jesus was referring to. The Word of God manifests the glory of God. The Word of God manifests the glory of God. The Word of God brings forth the glory of God like a baby in the fetus. When the Word of God is introduced into your system, into your spirit, is a seed from the Father, and it's bound to bring forth the fetus. It is formed the moment you speak it. Hallelujah. It is formed the moment you declare it. It is formed the moment you decree it. He's taking us out of our comfort zones. He's taking us out of the comfort zone of one healed man in a year. Two healed migraines in 2 years. One malaria fever gone in 10 days. I'm talking about an everyday glory. Are you here, church? Can you hear? The power of, and that's why the glory, however, it springs from a surrender. We have to surrender. We have to surrender. And what do I mean by that? The faith of the believer is actually the choreography of his surrender to the power and to the faithfulness of God. I'm going to say that again. The faith of a believer is his spiritual choreography of his trust, his confidence in God. Are you here? When we say, I have faith, we're talking about words. How many of you know that? You know that, right? Praise the Lord. When you say you have faith, you're actually saying, I have words. How many of you know that? You know that? Praise the Lord. Do you know what I'm talking about? I said, when you say you have faith, you're actually saying, I have words. So show me a man of faith, I will show you a man with words. So when you ask your neighbor, could you maybe ask your neighbor and say, do you have faith? Do you have faith? You got faith? Now, neighbor, you look at him or her and say, yeah, I got words. So the power of faith is the Word of God in your spirit. And so faith becomes your spiritual choreography, displaying your trust in God. So faith does not only come by hearing, it comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Now let me break that down, because I think it's a very popular place in the Bible that, you know, these demons of misinterpretations just overshadow it, and everybody just say like a national anthem that a lot of people cannot remember. But they believe they know it somewhere. But look at this. I want to teach you something very quickly about faith. I know time is fast spent, but I really am trying to make sure this ends on time. But look at this. The power of faith is the Word of God in your spirit. But faith, the Bible says, comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And a lot of people always say that faith comes by hearing the Word. I mean, it comes by the Word of God. But that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, faith comes by hearing, and then say hearing comes by the Word of God. So faith comes by hearing. Some say faith comes by hearing, and then hearing comes by faith. Hearing comes by the Word of God. We're going to say it again. I want you to choose one person beside you and be the first person to talk and say, faith comes by hearing. Now neighbor, I want you to reply and say, and hearing by the Word of God. What you see now is there's a two side to this definition of faith. Faith is not the hearing alone, and faith is not the Word of God alone. Faith comes by hearing. Faith comes by hearing. By this, I don't mean a denomination or word of faith. Anybody can call himself a word of faith preacher. I mean, I've seen Word of Faith Church, you know, that sells, you know, eggs for people to eat to get their deliverance. Anybody can be Bank of America or GT Bank. But when you go to a particular branch, they have different offers. The GT Bank in a rural area is different from the one in BI. There's a difference, but it's the same name. So calling yourself a word of faith church doesn't mean you are manifesting the reality of it. Do you get what I'm trying to say here? So the word of faith is a word that activates the glory of God in you, going somewhere, around it up. Now, the first thing we see here is that faith comes by hearing. So a faith that is from God comes to you first. The first time it comes to you, it comes by hearing the word. It doesn't come by the word. It comes by you hearing the word alone. Trust me, I think we have a lot of gospel stations around the world right now, maybe over 2 million of it. And we have a lot of devotionals around the world. We have a lot of bookshops that are dedicated to the gospel. If faith comes by hearing the word alone, trust me, everybody should have faith right now. If faith comes by hearing, if faith comes by just the word, Abba House should not be where we are today. Someone say, we won't be here today. If faith is just hearing the word. Oh, we all testify about the word that we hear in Abba House Nation. We all talk about it so greatly and so powerfully and all of that. But there's a difference between hearing the word. There's a difference between the word of God coming to you and you hearing the word. There's a difference. And that's what he's telling us, that faith, first of all, comes by hearing. And then hearing comes by the word of God. In other words, what I'm hearing is very important, but it has to come from the word of God. So the important reality of faith is what is heard, which springs from the word, the Bible. Come and talk to me. Come on, do you understand me so far? I can't see you, so I need to know that you can hear me. And I need to know that you're getting this still right. So here, what we're saying is, the faith of God comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. So faith does not come having heard the word of God. I heard it before. I mean, everyone that preached today has basically preached from almost the same part of the Bible. The Gospels talks about the birth of Jesus, how the Holy Spirit came upon him, and how he called the disciples, and how he died. But four of them have different revelation. Lately, I started doing a study on four of them. Oh, you will be so blessed and be shocked about many things that are in there. Because you have to recognize this. That faith does not come by you having heard the word of God. If I ask you, have you heard about the blood of Jesus? Everybody will raise their hand. But you see a lot of believers, when people pray and they say something about the blood of Jesus, they say, the blood of Jesus. You see, that tells you that they have heard the word that speaks about the blood. They have heard sermons. I've watched many great pastors talk about the blood, the blood, the blood. Whether it is right or not, they know about the blood. When I see the blood, I'll pass and I see the blood. They know that song. They sing it a long time. But when you get to a point where you realize that they don't know how to use that blood of Jesus or what that blood of Jesus really is, it's just a song to them. It's just something they wrote on their rhema notes. See, they heard the word, but in hearing, we have not heard anything. I'm talking about the church that is not striving to be glorified, because it has glorified her already. But I'm talking a church that will not strive and struggle to walk in the glory. Why? Because she's a church that understands the principle of the word, and that word comes through what we call faith. So faith comes by hearing in the now. What we're hearing right now, what we're using right now. For instance, I know some of you are writing some things down. I could see some of you write some things down and all of that. But Are you writing it? Are you really writing it down for it to penetrate your spirit? There was a time I was a little bit mad about with someone about, okay, in all that was preached and all that was said, somebody called in yesterday and I was asking Pastor Diola some questions about this and that. I was mad. I said, is this the first time that this person would know this? These are things that we have preached and taught and preached and taught and preached and taught in the church. Nobody should be asking such questions anymore, especially at that level. Why was I saying that? Because it is possible for you to haven't heard the word of God, haven't written it down in your book, haven't heard about it, haven't done all those things that you had to do. You see, you still don't understand it. How many of you can agree with me that you've written a lot of things in your book, but you didn't really understand? You didn't really hear it. Because if you heard it, you will understand it actually. But because you didn't really hear it. And so what is Pastor talking about? What do I mean by that? When manifestation, this is why manifestation is slowed down. And some of you think that you have the right to blame God. I've prayed about it, I've fasted, I've confessed, I've done this, I've done that about it. But you are doing it from sense. You're not doing it from your spirit. You're doing it as a calendar. A calendar that needs to be observed. You're doing it as a calendar that needs to be observed. I got to respect my pastor. I have to respect my pastor. I cannot argue with my pastor. But the day the pastor messes up. I mean, I've heard a lot of people tell me some things. And I've heard some funny things from pastors. People who pretend to be Aarons and all of that around them. And when they look them in the eye and say, Pastor, forget it though. if you talk again, I'll slap you. And these are people who have given the impression that they understand and they believe the truth of the Word of God. But the Word of God has no place in their life. Let me tell you something. The Word of God cannot attach itself to the spirit of a man or a woman who has not given it a place in his spirit. Let me say that again. The Word of God cannot attach itself to a man or a woman who has not given the Word of God a place to stay in his or her spirit. It's not possible. Some of you don't know this, but the Word of God has a way of haunting people who are open to him, even after 3 and 4 days and 5 days. After Azusa Street revival, 3 days later, there were men who kept praying and they couldn't stop. When the glory of God is in a room and is upon the preacher, you can tell by the way the congregation receives it as well. You have meetings that people struggle to leave them in the auditorium. You have meetings that people have a weight upon them. You have meetings that people are just weak on the chair. That is the glory of God resting upon the words that came to you. Are you still here, church? So when we're talking about faith, we're not talking about faith that comes by hearing or having heard the word of God. I've heard about righteousness before, but you still struggle about, you know, righteousness. You still have to pray for forgiveness every day, about intentional, daily, habitual sins. And then you expect your anointing and your grace to multiply. Come on, talk to me, church. And that is why we don't have a phage impact or a phage effect. Come on, talk to me. We don't have a phage effect in the church anymore. Because faith is not just hearing the word of God. Faith, it comes by hearing in the now, what I'm hearing right now. Sometimes you ask people, what did I teach last week? And they look at you like Alice in the Wonderland. And you're wondering, and then the same person is broke. The same person needs money. The same person doesn't have a job. The same person, you know, and then he's expecting one pastor to produce money from the mouth of the fish. No, if money ever comes out of the mouth of the fish in this church, trust me, it's going to be for the ministry. Hallelujah. So you got to understand these things. The glory realm is suspended when faith has not become a reality to us. Because only faith can penetrate the glory realm. Only faith can penetrate the glory realm. The glory that we are talking about. I'm going to expand shade on this tomorrow. And Lord, you cannot miss tomorrow. And please, you got to fix this thing tomorrow, this whole thing tomorrow. We need to get something in our spirit. Abba House, this is a turning point. Today, right now, this minute is a turning point. The people that are coming for FGR are coming to meet a fresh, refreshed Abba Nation. Say amen to that. I'm talking about a church that is not striving. I'm talking about a church that's not struggling. I'm talking about a church that is propagating the supernatural as a commonplace. I'm talking about a church that is penetrating the glory realm from the faith realm. The glory realm is not suspended, but there is a cloud upon their head. There is a release, daily release of something new upon their lives. Hallelujah. Faith comes by hearing. Present continuous word. It comes by hearing. Hearing. Present continuous word. Present continuous. It is not having heard. It's a continuous hearing. Notice it says faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word. So please, there are two sides of faith. You hear it, and then you hear it from the word. So what does it mean to have a word to hear? What does it mean to hear? Hallelujah. Because if faith comes by the word alone, trust me, there's no man that will be broke in this church. If faith comes by just the word alone and the CDs in our car seats or in our media, wherever, or those songs on our others titubed songs on our if faith comes by that, we will not be here today as a church. We will not be here as a church. We will have taken the world by storm. The people that are sitting in that place will not be sitting there right now. And I don't mean just physically, spiritually. And I don't mean just spiritually. I'm talking about making an impact in lives and nations. Taking the divine presence of God to the nation would have become a reality and an experience to some of us. Hallelujah, someone. So faith will not come to people on ShopRite that because we are projecting Matthew chapter something, verse something, and is on the billboard. Nobody is going to have faith just by knowing that word or by hearing that word. It's not going to come by that. It's going to come by you hearing. Let me put something to you. Turn to Isaiah in chapter 6, verse 9. I want to quickly teach you one or two things. And another, you can also turn to Mark chapter 4 in verse 12. Let me quickly teach you this. Hallelujah. Isaiah in chapter 6. Verse 9. The Bible says, and he said, go and tell these people, hear ye indeed, but understand not. And see ye indeed, but perceive not. In other words, you can hear, but you will never understand. You can see it, but you never perceive it. So God, more than just hearing the word of God, wants us to understand the word. God, more than just us seeing the word, wants us to perceive the word. In verse 10, it says, make the heart of these people fat. And then say, make their ears heavy and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and convert and be healed. Look at this. Isaiah had a mandate to go and tell the people of God that you've been hearing all these things. I've prophesied about Jesus. I've prophesied about Mary. I've prophesied about Herod. I've prophesied about the death of Jesus. I've prophesied about the 12. I've prophesied about all those things. You know them, but you never heard them. That means hearing is understanding it. Seeing is perceiving it. Did you hear what I said right now, church? In verse 10, how do you do that? He said, when you teach, when you preach, he said, make the heart of the people fat. So number one thing we see here about someone that is hearing, what we call the hearing of faith, is that his heart is fat. Say with me, say, my heart is fat. when your heart is fat, it's talking about the nourishment that surround the core of your being. That you are more than the pastor or the sister or the brother with tie and shoe and nice heart and nice word and a nice belt and nice department, a nice designation in church. But it's gonna be about the heart that is fat. See, what fat talks about? The juice of the Holy Ghost, of the anointing that is poured in your heart. It's talking about the leap of God's power into your heart. It's talking about the reality of the scripture becoming an experience implanted into your heart. He said, I've committed you to the word of God that is able to save you. And I said something about taking out the superfluity of naughtiness and embracing what the engrafted word of God. The word engrafted means it is entwined, embroidered, sewn into you. So he's talking about a people who come and when they hear the word, they are hearing. And that means that their heart is fat. When they come out of service, they are not all about Chelsea and Manchester United. They are not all about make a funny joke that was made last night by Teju Babyface. Or somebody says something about, go and look at the Facebook of a lot of Christians. You know who they are. Go and check their Facebook timeline. You know who they are. The kind of videos they share, the kind of things they talk about. Some of them you wonder, did you ever come to our house? Do you ever even go to any Bible believing church? Because their hearts are not fat. And the second thing he talked about is the fact that he said, Isaiah, when you preach, he said, make their ears heavy. Oh, glory to God. Make their ears heavy. The ear that is heavy is the one that has been flourished, or that has been furnished rather, with the revelations of God. Are you hearing this? The revelations of God. As your pastor is preaching, though he's preaching about maybe discipline, but that word, when it's coming to your ear, you're not only hearing discipline, you're hearing more than that. Does anybody have a witness to what I'm saying here? You know, your ears are heavy. Oh my God, and that's why I choose the meetings that I go for. Oh, recently I was in Fort Worth, Texas, and my ears were heavy. Oh, I told Pastor Tor, I said, I gotta go out. I said, I've got to go out right now. I can't take it no more. It was like a shower of revelation of my spirit. I heard more than Kenneth Copeland and Bill Winston and Jesse and all of them have to say put together. I heard more. I was spinning in my seat because I was not there just to hear the scripture, the word. I was there to hear the hearing of faith. And I knew they were talking about me, even though they didn't mention my name. That's the ear that is heavy. The ear that is heavy knows how to pick what it belongs to him. What God is saying about him, a confirmation about a dream. He just knows that, wow. And so when you say, our service, and he said it was awesome, he knows what he's talking about. It's not just a cliche. The third thing, he said, lest they see with their eyes. He said, shut their eyes. In other words, you gotta close their natural eyes. When the hearing of faith is experienced, the eyes are shut. Why? Because faith is the substance of things so far. It's the choreography of the title deed of our trust in God. So our natural eyes are shut. You see, that was a problem with Martha. Our natural eyes were up and shining, and they can see, like what Nigerians would call shine your eyes. They could see it. And what God is saying is, you cannot shine your eyes and walk in faith. Because when you see it the way everybody sees it, you see the cancerous virus as it eats up the body. You see how bad it is and how impossible it is. You read the medical reports of the doctors and you conclude it's got to be this. It's already late. It's 4 days late. There's nothing I can do about it. But I've got news for you. If the word of God can penetrate your spirit and you can shut your eyes to the realities of the world, because until you shut your eyes, you will not see what God is saying in the spirit. That's why the Bible says that your eyes of understanding being enlightened. Oh, glory. Your eyes of understanding being enlightened. In other words, you got to shut your eyes now in the physical or in the natural for you to be able to see what the supernatural has to offer. A lot of people in this church, we don't see the way God sees. And that's why we don't talk the way God talks. And that's why we don't act the way God expects us to act. The disciples said to Jesus, if he's sleeping, then why are we going to disturb him? And then when they realized that he had died, he said, why do we have to go and die with him? Okay, let's go and die with him. You see, their eyes told them what to do. But we are led by the Spirit. We are the generation that is led by the Spirit. We are the creation that is following the leadership of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. He said, lest they will hear with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart. So at the end of the day, what does it mean to have a hearing of faith? It is when your heart is fat, your heart is nourished with the word of God, and your ears are heavy with revelation, and your eyes are shut to natural things, so you can see the reality of the supernatural, and you can think and see with the eyes of the Spirit. You see with the seven eyes of the Holy Ghost, and you can see with ears, and you can hear what God is saying, even in the midst of the impossibility. What is uncomfortable for you, because you feel uncomfortable with it, does not mean it is not written. And that's why it takes a man that is surrendered to walk in faith. Hallelujah. And he said, and convert and be healed. If you are in Mark chapter 4, Jesus repeats the same thing. He said unto them, unto you is given to know the mystery of the kingdom, talking to the disciples. And he said, but unto them, they are without all these things done in parables. In other words, they can understand me, they can hear me, they can understand exactly what it is. In verse 12, he said, and seeing they may see and not perceive. The same thing Isaiah says, and hearing they may not hear and not understand. He said, lest at any time they should be converted and their sins be forgiven. Are you getting this? So at the end of the day, these are the same people that will eventually, you know, follow Jesus, and then, you know, they are looking for two fishes of five loaves. And after Jesus, you know, I don't know if you are in that place in your Bible, but if you read, I think you should take your time and read Mark chapter 4. It's a very comical, funny, but very revelatory. Because Jesus was talking to them and he said, to you is given to know the mystery of the kingdom. But when you go further in verse 35, the same people in verse 35 and 36 thereabout, you see that the same disciples that Jesus said, you know the mystery of the kingdom of God, they were the ones struggling and saying, how are we going to feed these people? The same people. That tells you that they heard, but they did not have faith. Because having heard is not what brings faith. It is when your ears are heavy and your heart is fat and your natural eyes are shut. We call it the faith and the glory experience, because until we begin to close our eyes, we cannot experience the supernatural glory. Hallelujah. They came, they listened, they even asked questions, yet Jesus said they didn't have faith. I mean, it gets worse that even when they went further, in the same place, there was wind blowing, and Jesus was sleeping at the bottom of the deck. And then they went to meet him and say, don't you care? Don't you really care about us that, you know, we might die? That's a disciple talking to Jesus like that? And you wonder, so all those parables, all those things, even when you said you didn't have two fishes and five loaves, I mean, the man just multiplied two fishes and five loaves. What's your problem, dude? I mean, just imagine. And then you say, don't you care that we die? And that's exactly where some of us are. We have iPads, we have beautiful Jordans, you know, made in Dubai. And we have it, you know, we have the iPad 7, iPhone 7, you know, whatever it is, we have it. I see some people that don't know anything come with phone, and they are trying to search the Bible through their phone. Let me say it here. The people that do that are people that we can only assume that they know the Word of God very well. When they say open your Bible, some of you need to carry a big Bible to church where you can see it very well. Because the glory we're talking about is going to spring from the Word. And that word has to spring from your spirit, not from your lips. Are you still here, church? That's why some of us immediately, just 2 days later, we already say, don't you care that we die? And wondering, were you in church on Wednesday or what? In Galatians in chapter 3, you know, Paul was telling the Galatians. He said, he therefore that ministers to you by spirit, worketh miracles among you, doeth he by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? He was asking them, is it the miracles that you've seen around among you, you think it's done by works? See, it's done by the hearing of faith. It is it by hearing the word of God. No, he said, hearing of faith. Because faith comes by hearing. He said, even as Abraham believed and it was counted unto him for righteousness, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. He was referring to us. He said, we are of faith. In other words, we have the ability to believe God. We are born, we are faith bones. We are born to believe God. Hallelujah. Are you here, somebody? Come on, are you here? That's why he says, for I say through grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according as God has dealt with every man. The measure of faith. The measure of faith. I don't care when you got saved or when you started attending the church or who invited you to the company. But I know if you're born again, you have the measure of faith at work in you. You have the measure of faith. But it has to go up. Because I said, it has to go up. The measure has to go up. Look at somebody and say, it has to go up. The measure of your faith has to go up. Tell him again. Go to at least tell them your measure of faith has to go up. Your measure. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Living sacrifice. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of the Lord, to present your bodies and living sacrifice, only acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable sacrifice. And be not conformed to the world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove that which is good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Living sacrifices. These are people of faith. Living sacrifice are a people of faith, state of surrender to the will of God and to the power of God, that it may increase, that I may decrease, that his glory be seen, that the excellency of his power be at work in me. Are you hearing this? And that's why Abraham was counted for as righteousness. The hearing of Abraham was a hearing of surrender. When you read about Abraham, you saw how he surrendered to the reality of God's power. He was old, he had no child, and 25 years after that, he still had no child. But he still had to believe that to entertain angels and he had to move. He had faith not just to leave his father's house, he had faith to believe that Isaac would come after Ishmael had already come. That is surrender. That is a living sacrifice. You feel the sacrifice. Some of you are running away from ministry and you're running away from praying. It's just hard on your body. I understand you. That's the way it ought to be. That's how it has, there's no praying around it. God cannot take that burden off you. You are going to have to break the power of the flesh over your life. You're going to have to stay in the place of prayer again and let that power be stirred up again. You're going to have to pray until your spirit affects your soul and your soul affects your body. Are you hearing me? He had faith. He left. The Bible said he was sojourning everywhere. He couldn't stay. He was living in tents, carrying in himself, in his loins, Jacob and Isaac. He had no child. He still believed. Some of us get to a point where things are, you know, I think there's a part of us that just believes that nothing bad should happen. I was just sharing with somebody earlier this morning that people always just, they don't know when God is testing them. They don't know when God is testing what they have heard, because it was a hearing of faith. When it is tested, it goes through and it comes out the same way. It doesn't change. The words that some of you have heard when we were on campus is now testing you. The words that some of you heard 3 years ago is now testing you. The Bible says of Joseph that the word of the Lord tested him. He was tried by the word of God. And that can only be so, you can only survive that if it was in the first place a hearing of faith, not mental accent. Are you still here? Are you still here? That's the word of God for you. In Exodus chapter 34, the Bible says when Moses was coming down, when he was going, let's talk about when he was going to the mountain. The Bible didn't say he went with even a Bible. The Bible didn't say that he went to a special mountain that God always appears. No, the Bible didn't even say that he went with a Goya horn, Goya butter. Those are the things that people walk around with. Search an average lady looking for a man. She has a Goya oil in her bag. Check an average man, a Christian that doesn't have a job. He has candles somewhere that he needs to burn every night. Check a woman of God that is facing some issues here and there. Check there's salt somewhere in the house for her to bathe at one. The church tried over and over again to spiritualize their weakness. Since when did candle become a substitute for the word of God in your spirit? Come on, can I talk to you, church, or you just want us to just do a religious ritual and go home? When did the church become a church of candles and garments and oil and handkerchiefs and vomiting and lying to people making your hand look like something because you want to pray for people? Where did we get this nonsensical deliverance ministry? How did we get there? Imagine from the perspective of God, who killed his only begotten son for the whole world and said it was finished. Watch people say they are looking for deliverance and that his church still conducts deliverance. When Moses was going up to meet with the Lord, he entered into the presence of God on that mountain without any oil or bottle or handkerchief. God did not even lay hands on him. But when Moses was coming down, the Bible says that he didn't even know that the skin of his face was shown, was it lit up. While he talked, when he got down to the foot of the mountain, he He covered his face with a veil. I'm going to deal with that tomorrow. Because it was fading out. They covered it. They couldn't look him in the eye. They had to cover him. Think about what I'm talking about. Some of you have seen it in the movies, but you didn't think that was what the Bible was talking about. You've seen it in the Bible. You've seen it in X-Men. You've seen it in some of these supernatural movies. You've seen the man look at someone and cut a big iron with the kind of laser that is coming out of his eyes. That was what they saw in the eyes of Moses. That was the glory of God. When he was coming down, the glory was upon him. They couldn't look at him. He shined like the sun. Moses came down from the mountain. We didn't go up to the mountain with the bottle. We didn't go with a handkerchief. We didn't go. God didn't even lay hands on him. God didn't roll him up and shake him up and he's dead sea when he came out. No. Imagine he lived in that place for 40 days just listening to God. Some say listening to the word of God. He was just listening to the word of God. Only words. And then people saw the glory. Only words. And then he came down and laser beamed out of his eyes. They couldn't look at him. You will become untouchable when the word of God finds a place in your spirit. You become untouchable. You become a general. You become a miracle walker once that word dwells in your spirit. We will not struggle with what we're struggling with right now, church, if the word of God really had a place in your spirit. The Israelites, unfortunately, heard the same God. There were many times that God spoke to them corporately, and yet none of them had a laser eye. None of them has a laser eye. Why? Because in hearing, they did not understand. In seeing, they could not perceive. Their eyes were not heavy. Their ears were not heavy. Their eyes were not fat. Their natural eyes were up. They complained daily. They were wondering what's going on. They were spectators of the anointing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, tell me that you heard something. Tell me you are hearing something. Hallelujah. Only words, and then the glory of God was upon him. Do you know that the law was given to Moses so that the children of Israel would not die? Do you know that the law was not given so that they could die? No, the law was actually given to destroy sin and death. That's why the apostle said the law is good. Really, why do you think the police officer stops you on the road? Well, I don't know of Nigeria. Okay, I think I do. But they stop you for your own safety. If you ride a bike in this country and you don't have a helmet, they're going to stop you. In fact, people that ride bike have a different driver's license. He's not the same class as people that drive the truck and all of that. Why are they doing that? Because they want to save from accident. 95% of the reason why they arrest us is actually for our safety. But look at it. God gave them the law and all of them started dying. Why? Because the word of God never found a place in their heart. He was never a hearing of faith. They didn't understand it. The moment there was a bitter water, they complained and abused God and all. There was no food in the afternoon. They jumped out at Moses, and Moses would go to God and vice versa. They couldn't endure anything. They couldn't trust God just one more minute. They were going to lynch Moses because they just wanted revival right now. But look at Joshua and Caleb. The Bible said they had a different spirit. everybody died, but not the tribe of Judah, not the tribe of Gideon. No, we have to talk about people who survived that time. And we have to talk about them as a people of faith, because it must be the hearing of faith that penetrated their spirit, that raised a standard against sin. Are you still here, church? But today, many are running everywhere. Colossians in chapter 3, verse 10, it may say, and we have put on what a new man, that is renewed. He's renewed in knowledge. He's renewed in revealed knowledge. When Moses was coming down from that mountain, he had a renewed knowledge of God. It was not just Jehovah Roy. No, he had a different knowledge of him. Listen, child, but the moment you begin to study your Bible, I was telling Pastor Dale, I said, I don't think people really care about the Bible reading glad in the devotional. Because there were lots of errors sometimes back because of the person handling it. And nobody ever called to correct it because nobody cared about it. And it's the reason why we do that to you as a church is because we want you to grow. We want you to hear the word of God and hear it until it becomes an experience, until your ears are heavy, until your heart is fat, until your natural eyes are blind. And the Spirit of God enlightens your spiritual eyes to see. Hallelujah. When the Word of God penetrates your spirit, it renews your knowledge about God. All of a sudden you wake up and say, no, I can't die. Also you wake up and say, no, my children are coming. You wake up and say, no, this is not the end of it. I have a job now. You wake up, you just do it, and you know, hallelujah. So we're meant to not just renew our mind, we have to renew in the knowledge of Him that has created us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So when it says, arise and shine, the glory of God is risen upon you. We talked about this a lot in January. Arise and shine. He didn't say arise and reflect the glory. There's a difference. Arise and mirror the glory. Arise and shine. I'm not saying to reflect. Radiation and reflection are two different things. Hallelujah. The glory of God is risen upon us. Hallelujah. That means that the glory of God is at work in us already. Hallelujah. So when we say the glory of God is at work in us. Then my heart is fat, my ears are heavy, my eyes are shut. The glory of God is at work in me. Come on, I said you should say that to yourself. No wonder the Bible says that the earth shall be filled with the glory of God. Habakkuk wasn't saying that there's going to be a shining or a rainbow or a comet, which is what some people call glory. No, that's not glory. He wasn't saying fire will come from heaven or out of the sky, there will be a sign. No. Habakkuk was prophesying about the church of Jesus. Hallelujah. Let me round up by saying this. Go to Acts chapter 3. Let's round up with that. Glory. Did you get something? Acts in chapter, what did I call it? Chapter 3. Glory. The word of God in us brings a new knowledge of God in our spirit, and then it changes us and we become more like God. That's what Colossians chapter 3 said. That's what Paul said, I commit you to the word of God that is able to save you. The word of God is very important. You can shout glory and talk glory all day, all kind of meeting. I still don't understand some things. Hallelujah. Look at verse 6. The Bible says, and Peter says, silver and gold I have none, but that which I have. Someone said, that which I have, I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up, walk. Did you see that? He said, that which I have. What is that? That's in this scripture. Of course, it refers to Jesus. Some say, I have Jesus. So, rather than say, that which I have, Peter could have said, although he said it much later, he could have said, silver and gold, I have none. Jesus, I have, and I'm giving you. Therefore, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Child of God, you need to rise and announce to your problems, your ministry, your dying ministry, your state of everything, and announce to them that which you have. Announce to them that which you have. It is not the end of your life. It's not the end of your ministry. It's not the end of your career when the silver and gold are missing. You look at your husband and your husband looks at you and you don't have money at home. And your house is $1 house. Your house is $1. Somebody's got $1 shop. So even if your house is $1 house, your chairs are $1, your everything is $1. You look at yourself and say, that which we have. No, we're not broke because we don't have silver. You know, we talk about the CC and we talk about money. And we are brainstorming. How do we do this? How can we do this? How do we? We projected a lot for sovereign. Oh, what are we going to do? How are we going to do? And all. But I came to announce to you that which we have. You don't look excited, but that which we have will fix this. Church, as long as we have Jesus, our people are coming out, our people are getting the best of jobs. This faith. The faith upon the field. As your ears get fuller and your ears get heavier and your eyes and your flesh are closed, I declare in the name of Jesus that which we have shall manifest in our lives. That which we have shall manifest in our lives. You know, Paul said, but we see the glory of God. He said, we have not seen anything yet under its feet. But we see Jesus. We see Jesus. The husband needs to look to the wife and say, I see, we see Jesus. Silver and gold we have none. But we see Jesus. I'd rather lose silver and gold. I'd rather be broke of silver and gold rather than be broke of the name of Jesus. Like the sons of sin. I'm going to go back to the place of prayer. I'm going to go back to the place of meditation. I'm going back to believing in the word of truth. I'm going back to reminding myself who I am in Him. I'm going back to telling God that I put my hands on the plow and I'm not looking back. I'm going to go ahead and do those things. I'm going to go ahead and remind myself what I have. Remind yourself of what you have. And the Bible says in verse 7 that he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength. And can I shock you, church? Can you hear me? Can I shock you? Come on, can you hear me? The miracle of Acts chapter 3 was not the man at the beautiful gate asking for alms. the miracle of the beautiful gate was not the man who had been at that gate all his life. The miracle of that beautiful gate was Peter and John, who had walked with the master and had always been referred to as faithless. They were sleeping at Gethsemane, faithless. They complained about the wind, faithless. They went back to fishing after he died, faithless. They came to the womb and went back, to the tomb and went back, faithless. But they stood and they said, we don't have all the money, we don't have even what to give to you, but what you really need is what we have. What you need is what we have. What we need is what we have. What you need is what we have. Hallelujah. Get in this. What they need is what you have. I wish I could talk to the South African and to the Ugandans, that you should not be afraid of them that try to harass you, and the spirit of timidity that tells you don't talk like that, and tells you you are a stranger in the land. I say to yourself, God has given me the land and I'm going ahead to take over. Hallelujah. Are you hearing? Are you hearing this? And the Bible said, so you got to know Peter and John were the miracle. They came from faithlessness. And I wish that somebody would go with that faith today, would have a change in their spirit about what God is set to do today. The miracle of the beautiful gate was John and Peter. Because without them, the man would not have been saved. Hallelujah. And when you get the words in your spirit and you know what you have against what you don't have, you speak those words with power. Like Jesus, you say, Lazarus, come forth. Announce the status that you desire. Don't announce the status of what you seek or what you perceive. You got to announce the status of what you desire. Hallelujah. Are you hearing this? And let's wake up and become heaven's power department in the earth. Let's wake up and become heaven's power department. We're not a feeble church. We're not a church that they laugh at as they do today. We're not a church of inconsistency. We're a church that has been called to glory. We're a church that has been called, justified, and glorified. We're a church that glory is our predestination. That's it. We're the church that we have no choice because we hail from glory. And therefore, we have to do glorious things in the earth. Glorious things in the body of people. Glorious healing taking place. I'm talking about miracle financially. I'm talking about miracle of all kinds. Sudden possibilities gushing out towards you like never before. Because the faith starts with you. In the name of Jesus. Come on, you the word of God. Rise to your feet and let's pray. Oh, my labor, Baba, would you just consecrate yourself to him right now? Come on now. I wish I could tell somebody. No, go have me tell somebody. Would you just start all over again already? Would you just put all the glories of the past in the past and let me do what I call what I want to do? Elemendro Sukumurashke. And hear the Lord say, rise from the plains and move higher from where you are. For I've set to you as far as your eyes can see. Alimondo Sukupani Moshe. Wanda Leva Bobo Sula Kasha. Elimondo Sukileva Bahasha. The words took Lazarus out. The words that you speak right now will take you out of every deadness. I said the words that took Lazarus out of that place, but the word of Jesus. And you have that which I have, that which I have. I have the word of God. Jesus is the word of God. I said, that which that I have, I've given to you. I have what you have. What do you have? You have the word of God. That's the word of God. You have Jesus. Keep that word right now. Keep that word. Keep that word right now. Then the number is to the rush. Father, in Jesus' name, I want to quick this thing, just another 2 minutes and I'll be out of your way. But I feel this so strong in my spirit. I'm not permitted to tell you the picture I see in my spirit, but I'm going to give you the words. I'm going to give you the words. The cult has been tied now. And the word of the master has been released. But you are the custodian of that word. So the release of the cult is no more. Hear this. Hear this. Don't be distracted. Hear this, the release of the cult is no more the master's responsibility. The release of the cult is no more the master's responsibility. As my church looks around and there are cults around, tied down. Cults that are meant to be a reason for testimony and shining in the lives of my people. Cults, men and women that are meant to be part of the fold that I've called them to. Women that I've called into the ministry. To let my church know that the cults are no more the responsibility of the words of Jesus. For the word has been made flesh. And the word is nigh thee. Elemanda. And the word is in thy mouth. And I hear the Lord say, speak. Like Peter, that which I have. Say, I have given you Jesus. And I have given you the word. I have given you Jesus, the word of God. So when you speak the word of God, you have released Jesus to the atmosphere. So therefore, I have commanded you to go and release every cult that has been tied down by words. So do not expect the word from me, for I have given you the word. I have given you my son, the one that represents the word itself. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. In him was all things made, and nothing without him was made. I said, in him was life, and that life was the life of man. He said, I have given you the word to be your life. He said, in your life is my word ready to do wonders. He said, but you're going to have to speak it. And so in the next one minute, I want you to move around if you want to, kneel down if you want to, and if you can get the scripture now, fine, but try to get it later. But speak words, quote the Bible, paraphrase it if you know how you have it, but release that word that's happening in your life. You're looking for a job. You're looking for health. You're looking for ministry. You're looking for an increase in your finances. You are looking for peace in your marriage. Come on, somebody, release God. Release the cult. Release. In the name of God. Right now, His word has taken. His word, and then this. In Jesus' name, we pray. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Break it down. I want to make one more order, one altar call before I go. I know a lot of us here are born again, but if you're not born again, please, I give you the permission to walk to any of the pastors, or just tell anybody beside you and tell them you're not born again. They lead you to Christ. But most importantly, I want to do this. If you're here and there's just an overall burden for you to start all over again when ministry is concerned, I want you to step out. Remember, I'm not there, but my words will go as far. And I don't care what hierarchy or who you think you are. If you know you're Noah, and this should be perceived as an altar call of a new beginning and grace. He said, come to the throne of grace and obtain mercy. This is a call to the throne of grace. Our nation, we've lost a lot of generals, not to death, but we lost a lot of generals to lukewarmness. The people that the word of God has no more impact in their spirit. And we have normalized a lot of abnormalities that should never have taken place in our church. Whatever you do, whatever department you are, this is a higher calling. And I hear repentance in my spirit. Those of you in front of you, please, can you do something between you and God? And I am a witness. Open your mouth and say, forgive me my trespasses. Open your mouth and pray and say, Lord, forgive me my trespasses. Yes, that's not in the Bible for decoration. Our trespasses takes us away from the reality of faith. Our trespasses are enemies that affect our relationship with God. Our trespasses is our flesh. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There's such an anointing all around the room right now. Please, let's be solemn. Let's just receive this order, gladness. And I hear the Lord say, but they are the planting of the Lord. They are the planting of the Lord. They are the planting of the Lord. They are a cult being released according to the word of faith that we have preached here today. And by the grace of God, the power and the name of Jesus, I release you today as cults to be a general in your generation. To be a man and a woman after God's heart. To be a man and a woman that understand who they are in God and will take their place in God. But I ask for strength, and I ask for a revelation of yourself to them, that they will not know you through somebody else or what you did to somebody else. That they will know you by experience in the name of Jesus. I command deadness And I declare the life in my words to resurrect in the name of Jesus. I decree a rhema resurgence upon every deadness in the valley of the bones right now in the name of Jesus. I declare the fire shut up in your bones to have expression right now in the name of Jesus. I release the glory of God upon you through these words, and I declare that weaknesses shall burn in the name of Jesus. I declare the harvest of wheat to germinate in your life in the name of Jesus. I decree that you are in white field and the harvest is coming and is here now in the name of Jesus. I declare everything that concerns you is perfected by the Lord in the name of Jesus. Elamando subre ali and the rashke subre ali and the susta. Elando kujo no subre ila. Is taking you out of your comfort zone. Listen, comfort zone is a sin for the next level. When the next level is what you want, comfort zone must be taken rid of. God is taking you out of your comfort zone. Do what you've never done before. Prepare a new calendar for every day. Have a constant time of prayer together with the Holy Ghost. Do it every day and be consistent with it. For the Lord is waiting on those that pant after Him as deers, and is willing to reveal Himself more to those who hear Him and love Him more. See how the Spirit goes. Alemandro Sushan Abbasos, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, God. Pastor Saint, Pastor Pastor Dapo, could you just empty lay hands on them? And as you lay hands on them, what you will realize, let me tell you what's going on in your spirit right now. The gift of God is being stirred. The gift of God is being stirred. You are not going to remain the same. Some of you are going home to dream. Some of you are going home to weep all night. Some of you are just going to have a funny demeanor during FGR because your ears are heavy, just your heart is fat. Father, we do this. Release the cause, release the cause, release the cause, release the generals, share the gift in them, share the gift in them. Bigger than Nigeria, it's bigger. Ovalosuka mandrilioso, jandalo, jandalo kuzumba ali in the system, elamondos de kumabojan, elamondos de kumabojan. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know that you have a gift of this and a gift of that. But somehow, they are locked down. They are not finding expression. At the laying of the hands of the pastors, there is a staring of the gift of God in you. Oh, glory, glory. Come on, church. Get ready for the display of the supernatural. What eyes have they seen before? The weak are strong now. The weak spirit. Let me be strong. One of you for your brother to be released in the world. I join my faith with you right now. I will declare the release of that. We go to the inner land. Because it was which man from predestination. Some of you perhaps look for the season. I hear the Lord say, I am giving my church a new parable, and shall be the parable of Jonah. Most of you think you should change this man because you have been weak for a month, or you have been down for a season. And I hear the Lord say, as it has been through, I have never changed my mind, but I knew I formed you, and I called you, and I ordained you, and as a result, today, the power of to fulfill destiny is upon you, in the name of Jesus. And I hear the Lord say, renewal of mind. Say, renew your mind, renew your mind, renew your mind. Be vigilant of what comes into your heart. The vigilance of what comes into your heart. May God also say, don't. And what don't is addressing a man and a woman. And this way, yes, one of you is 26, 23, and God is saying, you have told yourself, you're going to join the circle of those who are lukewarm. I'll just come to church. I'll just do what I gotta do. But the cost has been weighed and to please you because the assignment so never ask if they will make do I begin. Ask again, how am I going to ever get there? I am thy strength. It is not your mind, it is not your power. God is giving people cars. Cars. I see a lot of cars. The thirsty are satisfied now. Come on, lift your hand up. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Be glorified in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray, the church shouted, elevated.
Glory to God.
Thank you so much for your time. I know that the next session is going to be a glorious one, and I want to warn, a prophetic one, it's a prophetic alert. Go into FGR with a new cloud. Go into FGR like a man surrounded. Start a foot in your heart. The Lord is set to use you for his glory like never before. In Jesus' name.